Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Hemingway's Widow, The Life and Legacy of Mary Welsh Hemingway, by Tim Christian. Narrated by Tim Christian. To My Family. Preface. This is the Hemingway book we've all been waiting for so long. H.R. Stoneback. Today is one of those sudden sun-glory afternoons in the Hudson Valley, when the chill finally lifts and you can see the first hints of spring. It is the perfect weather to spend the afternoon sitting in the unshaded spot near the head of my driveway and read while I wait for the mail. I greet neighbors and other people taking advantage of the quiet side street in our small village, leading downhill to the Hudson River. It has been a pleasant ritual during this strange pandemic year of various states of isolation and conversational quarantine. My last public lecture on Hemingway was on a ship sailing the Caribbean in February of 2020, a ship that barely made it home to port before the lockdown started. Since then, about a dozen of my Hemingway lectures worldwide, from New York to New Orleans to Wyoming, from Florida to Ireland to France, have been canceled. I miss the passing conversations about Hemingway with strangers in far places. In this strange year of COVIDian metamorphoses, my travels have been mostly to my mailbox, and my conversations have mainly been with passers-by. I've lived quietly and mostly anonymously in my village, but some neighbors have seen announcements of my public lectures or reviews of my books in local newspapers. They know I'm a professor and some kind of writer, and some of them seem to think I'm so ancient that I used to hang out with Hemingway in Paris or Cuba or some old war or sporting glory. Neighbors are not to be held accountable for their flawed chronology. Most know me only as the writer guy or the Hemingway professor or the old writer dude that lives in the big haunted house above the river and loves to garden and talk about his garlic and leek crops and give his garlic and leeks away to neighbors. That is fine with me. It reminds me of long ago when I lived in a French village where people still believed what they read in the newspapers and still gardened and respected writers, and the only American writer they'd heard of was Hemingway. I've long observed that our first reading of really good books is mysteriously and inextricably bound up with the place where we did the reading. All good things are suffused with place, and it is if the deus loci summons us to read certain good books in certain numinous places. Today, then, I was sitting by my driveway, reading what had come in the mail 2 weeks before, a large, fat, heavy manuscript of 623 pages in the form of a spiral-bound Staples print job. I lost the first week after the manuscript arrived to the vaccine quest runabout and other daily necessities and interruptions. I lost most of the second week to urgent, round-the-clock communications with editors about the publication of my memorial ode for Jerry Jeff Walker, the legendary Texas singer-songwriter and my old hitchhiking buddy in the early 60s, and working out my role in the grand Jerry Jeff Memorial Show in Luckenbach later this year, where I will take the stage and sing with the likes of Ramblin' Jack Elliott, Emmylou Harris, Jimmy Buffett, Steve Earle, and other music legends who love Jerry Jeff as I do. My life and work is not all Hemingway all the time. It never has been. However, delightful crossovers do occur, such as the historic occasion when Mary Hemingway met Jerry Jeff Walker, described later in this book. With other pressing matters settled, I started reading the manuscript slowly, in the after-midnight hours, jumping around in the text, checking sources, doing the sideways scholarly recon often deployed in approaching a book. It was the final draft of another Hemingway book, a biography. I had known every Hemingway biographer since Carlos Baker. And even before Carlos and his first full-dress biography of Hemingway, I had known A.E. Hotchner and his Papa Hemingway meditation. I was still in mourning for Hotch since we lost him aged 102 last year as the pandemic started, and lately regretting that I had to cancel my last invitation to visit Hotch again at his home in Connecticut. I personally knew many of the primary sources, Hemingway's family and friends, and I knew the main character of the manuscript, entitled Hemingway's Widow, The Life of Mary Welsh Hemingway. I knew Mary Hemingway not as a subject for academic inquiry and scholarly interviews, but as a social friend to be cherished. Nothing written before brought to life the person I knew. That conviction, together with the more than 40 years spent on the front lines of Hemingway lit critical wars and scholarly skirmishes, led to a certain jaded and glutted feeling of satiety at the frontier of ennui, a place where there is nothing new under the sun when it came to all Hemingway books. This made my first approaches to this manuscript peripheral. I started at the back, jumping around here and there, source checking, writing brief marginal annotations, taking the temperature of the book, seeing if it tested negative or positive. But that's no way to read a good book. A good book deserves and demands more than circuitous post-midnight perambulation, or even the more devout, higher circumambulation. Besides, I prefer to read in natural light. Seeing that the forecast called for two consecutive warm, sunny days, I cancelled everything, turned my phone off, and started really reading the book straight through. The first long afternoon on my porch and in my mail-awaiting driveway, I read 253 pages. I stopped when the natural light dictated and resisted reading into the night because the feeling of reading outdoors seemed right for this book that was a rare breath of fresh air in Hemingway studies. Then, in the bright, clean, early spring light of the second day of plein air reading, I finished the last 311 pages of the narrative without even a coffee break. I closed my eyes in the late afternoon sun and thought, there is something new under the sun. This is a stunning achievement. Perfectly organized, impeccably paced, well written in clean, crisp prose, free from academic jargon and critical gibberish and psychoanalytical balderdash. My eyes still closed in meditation. I thanked my grandmother for that word. She was the only person I ever knew who could say the word balderdash 5 times in a conversation and give the word its appropriate authority and force. And Mary Hemingway reminded me of my tough, enduring, librarian teacher grandmother, who dealt admirably with the complexities and burdens of marriage to a talented husband who drank too much, among other excesses. I kept thinking about that heavy manuscript in my lap. Some revelations here, things we did not know before. Perspicacious throughout in its search for and interpretation of evidence, exactitude and amplitude, meticulous research, more than 50 pages of notes and documentation, always judicious in its assessments, and judicial when it needs to be, and how good it is to have at last a writer who brings to bear his vast legal experience on matters such as Hemingway's contracts and lawsuits and wills, something never before dealt with adequately. Most importantly, the real Mary Hemingway is brought to light and life and walks through these pages. I had been so absorbed in finishing my excited reading of the manuscript that I hadn't even opened my mail, delivered hours before, and I was still sitting by my driveway where the last afternoon sun slanted on my property. A voice broke into my reverie. "Beautiful day, ain't it now? You finish writing another one of your books, Mr. Writer?" I opened my eyes. "No, this one's not mine. It's the manuscript of a new Hemingway book." "So you got your Professor Hemingway hat on today?" "Semper Fi." I touched the Marine Corps cap I was wearing. He got my double meaning. "Semper," he said, and still standing maskless 6 feet away, he let enough leash out so his hound dog could wag tail, prance up, and lick my hand the way he always did when these conversations happened in passing once a month or so from spring to fall. I don't know the dog's name or the man's name, and I don't think they know my name. He always calls me Mr. Writer or Professor Hemingway, and the dog seems to agree. They live somewhere in the village, not in my immediate neighborhood, and he walks his dog past my house down to the Hudson several times a week when the weather is good. One thing we do know is that we are both ex-Marines. Correction. There are no ex-Marines. Once a Marine, always a Marine, as the Band of Brothers watchword goes. And we always recognize each other. I vaguely know that he has held all kinds of jobs, mostly in construction, and that he retired early, in his 50s, on disability from his last job as a heavy equipment operator. The only thing I know for sure about him is that he loves Hemingway and reads everything he can find by and about Hemingway. That's one of the great things about Hemingway, the only American writer who compels readers of all kinds, not just writers and academics and English majors and crusaders looking for a straw man writer to hate. So what's that there Hemingway book about? It's actually about one of his wives. I might ought to skip that one, then. I've had it up to here. He lifted his dog-free hand, making the usual gesture at his throat, with all them Paris wives and Key West wives, and all them wifeographies and all that damn I-don't-know-what emotional crap. Well, not that exactly. Just romantic greeting card stuff, or the opposite, which is just as stupid, and I don't know what to call any of it. Sentimental? Yeah, that's it. And it smells like toxic waste. He used to operate the bulldozer at the town dump. Sentimentality can be just as toxic as cynicism. You said it, brother. You might like this wifeography. It's the first one about Ham's last wife. What's it like? I never read anything but bullcrap about her. In his avoidance of the word bullshit, he was being genteel and polite to his distinguished neighbor. I couldn't think exactly what to tell him. I did not want to say, impeccably written, and meticulously researched, anchored in exactitude and open to amplitude. So I just said, "This is the Hemingway book we've all been waiting for so long. If you say so, I might better read it. You'll learn a lot of new things about him and his last wife, his most enduring and important mate, really comes alive in these pages. Then I'll get the book when it comes out. Something I know you won't remember, because I was just a scrawny, pimple-pocked kid just out of high school. But I was in the audience when you brought Mary Hemingway here and introduced her talk 40-some years ago. Really? That lecture at the university? Yep. That and her talk at the village library, too. I liked her a lot. I tried to buy her book, but she gave it to me and signed it, and I took it with me when I went away to the Marines. I remember all that like it was yesterday. I liked her a lot." I was happy to be reminded of Mary's village library visit. I always saw Mary in Manhattan, except for her one visit 80 miles north to my village at the end of her grueling, year-and-a-half-long tour, plugging how it was. I reckon maybe I talked her into what she called her last public talk, and I think it was her last, in late November 1977, at my university. She agreed to give the talk for the pittance my institution offered, about one-tenth of her normal lecture fee. I took that as an act of friendship. Driving her north to my home, I mentioned that the local village librarian asked if I could bring Mary by to sign a few of her books. It would only take a few minutes, I said, and we'd have plenty of time to relax and to eat something before her big evening lecture. To my surprise, she said enthusiastically, "Let's do it." Mary was a real trooper. I had arranged with Sparrow, my wife, that if Mary said yes to the library stop, we'd be there at a certain time, and if Mary said no, we'd go on to our house so she could rest, and I'd call Sparrow from home. So we stopped the village library, really a modest old house with cramped quarters and tight-packed bookshelves. I looked at my neighbor standing in my driveway, and I said, "I remember vividly Mary Hemingway's lecture at my university, but I'd forgotten all about the village library event, and I'm amazed that you were there. Tell me what you remember." "I recollect it like it was yesterday. I see you bringing Mrs. Mary in and taking her over to your missus, and then you went back outside. I was there before anybody else come, and I was carrying my guitar, coming home from a music lesson. Mrs. Hemingway says to me, 'May I please borrow your guitar for a minute?' And she did, and she played a few chords, and then her and your missus, that everybody called Sparrow, started singing, and it was that French lady song about no regrets that was my mamma's favorite, that Piaf lady, and her theme song. 'Non, je ne regrette rien.' That's the one. Then you come back inside and stood there towering over the both of them, and them the same height and neither of them a hair over 5 foot two, and them singing their voices, blending like sisters, and both of them had that low voice with a mystery thing in it, standing there singing like sisters 30 years apart. And then your Mrs. Sparrow took the guitar and played what I know was your theme song with her, because I heard you open many shows with 'I wished I was some little sparrow,' and that about "Come all ye fair and tender ladies," and then you harmonized with him on the next line, "Take warning how you court your men." Where did you see this show as I did with Sparrow? Every time I seen the ads in the papers about a show you was doing nearby. Maybe a dozen times over the years. Be meaning to tell you this every time I walk by and we talk. And once on stage you told the story how your wife got the name Sparrow. And that brought tears to my eyes, 'cause Piaf was my mama's favorite singer. His hound dog looked sad. Maybe we all did. That was one of Mary Hemingway's favorite songs too, I said. The reason this matters is because in Tim Christian's biography, one of the small but important pleasures and satisfactions, among all the major ones, is the plethora of references to Mary Hemingway's love of singing. I even think there is a reference to Mary singing Piaf, though I may have dreamed that. I just leafed through all the many pages where I penciled a checkmark next to references to Mary's joy in singing, but I can't find the ostensible Piaf reference now. The point is that if a biographer does not report his subject's love of singing, the life story remains untold, and maybe we should never trust a biographer who does not sing. In late 1963, my wife and I were on stage performing at a nightclub when the MC came on stage to report tearfully the news of the death of Piaf, the little sparrow. Then, dipping his fingers into his gin and tonic, the MC christened my wife the new sparrow. At first it was her stage name, but soon everybody around the country and the world called her Sparrow. We sang our way around the world, performing in 40 states and 40 countries, and for more than 40 years together, singing was a way of being. The reporter who does not know and understand that, even if he knows all my books, even if she knows all my hundreds of published essays and thousands of poems, knows nothing about my life. In this biography, I'm happy to say, I can hear Mary singing. And Ernest, too, even if he is somewhat off-key, but never mind. After reading this biography with its pervasive evidence of Mary's joy in singing, I will always remember her songfulness, especially when I read and hear the usual invidious comparisons of Mary with Hemingway's other wives. For Mary, singing was a form of social discourse and connection. Singing was fun. Singing was joy. And I do not mean art song, performance song. I mean folk songs and popular songs sung in the spirit of singing along together. I have read all there is to read and heard all the gossip about Hemingway's other wives, and I'm not sure if any of them really liked to sing, or if they were the kind of song shunners who retreated into silent corners or spouted weary witticisms while others sang. I could make a few untuneful suggestions about the singing identities of the other wives, but I won't. I do feel confident in saying that none of them would, like Mary, visit a local library and in an idle moment ask a local teenager if she could borrow his guitar and then play and sing with others, not as performance, but for joy. Is there anything better to do with idle moments than fill the silence with song? Singing is a way of being together. Delighted with my dog-walking neighbor's memories, I asked, "What else do you remember about Mary Hemingway's visit?" Well, maybe 20 people crowded into that small room where she sat at a desk and talked. She said a few words about Ernest and about her book. Then you announced that she would have to leave in a few minutes and that we were all welcome to come and hear her talk in the big lecture hall at New Paltz. You said she'd be happy to sign her book if we wanted to buy a copy from the librarian. Mrs. Hemingway was sitting at that desk with a cardboard box wrapped in green tissue paper, with a slit in the top and a sign that said, "Donations for Library Book Buying Support." I watched her rub her fingers over that sign on the box, and then she said, "I will give you these books and ask you to consider putting the purchase price in this library donation box." I think most of us did that. I know I did. I did not have much money, and I was about to spend almost all I had on her book, but I put it all in the donation box. It was the first charity gift I ever made, and I felt good about it. And after she signed all the books she gave away, I watched her reach in her purse and put a wad of bills that looked like mostly 20s in that box. If I noticed that, then I'd forgotten it. So Mary was a trooper, and a benevolent and generous trooper. What else do you remember? Well, after that signing of books, you all left the library, and 2 or 3 hours later, you arrived at that big lecture hall where the standing room only crowd was waiting. And you gave your fancy introduction of her, and then she talked some about Ernest, but talked much longer about what it was like living in London during the Nazi Blitz. It was better than any talk or program or movie I ever heard or watched about that war. It made me feel like I'd lived through the Blitz. She must have been one hell of a war correspondent. Some say she was. Anything else you want to say about her? I thought she was perky, tough, a grade-A talker, and right on. And I'll bet she was sexy as hell in her prime. I think you'll like this biography a lot. I got your word on that, and I'll be there with my bells on to buy that there book when it comes out. I might even buy a copy to give to my strange, estranged wife. She's like one of them whiny, snobbish Hemingway wives, and the whiny biographers who write about them. Somebody needs to tell them whiners to just sit foo. Excuse my marine mouth, but you know what I mean. Yes. Marines like acronyms, the pinnacle of pared-down prose and economy of speech. Unfortunately, decorum seems to forbid printing here what the acronym stands for. Just hand all the whiners a straw and don't even say sit-foo, my neighbor continued. You'd have to carry a lot of damn straws these days with whiners coming out of the woodwork everywhere. I'll bet nobody ever had to tell the one true tough Mrs. Hemingway to suck it up. Yeah, you'll like this biography. Makes the best case ever for Mary as the most important wife of all, with the toughest gig when Hemingway was alive and started falling apart. And after his death, she spent decades defending and advancing his literary legacy, always faithful. The Semper Gumby, Semper Fi wife. You got it. I had not heard anyone say Semper Gumby in decades. It is the other Marine Corps Semper, always flexible. And I've heard she could handle her liquor, too. Some folks in these parts still talk about how much she drank with you before she gave that great talk. Bartenders talk. Well, me and my old hound better move on to get home before dark. Semper, my good professor. Semper. Semper. I watched him walk away and I thought, well, there's another Hemingway interview done. I'd like to add him to all the other audiences I've had for Hemingway. Write for him. Lecture for him. Teach him. And learn from him. But there it was again, the story of Mary's drinking, and in particular a story still alive in regional oral tradition 43 years after it happened. That day, long ago, after our stop for the local library program, Mary and Sparrow and I went to our house for a spell. Sparrow had carefully put the gin and all other bottles of kindred spirits out of sight. She offered Mary some coffee and fruit juice, and they talked in the living room, then sang and played guitars again, while I got on the telephone to New Paltz, calling the restaurant where I planned to take Mary for something to eat before the evening program. I wanted to make sure Barnaby's was open and not too crowded, and I reserved a booth in the back corner as far from the bar as you could get, on the theory that the farther from the bar we were, the longer it would take to get drinks. In the time since Mary and I became friends, all the social and cultural events where we got together had an inclination toward and generous affection for alcohol. My main concern was keeping her reasonably sober before a big talk, and keeping myself reasonably sober enough to make an eloquent and elegant introduction. And like anyone who had visited Mary at her penthouse apartment, I knew she drank hard and fast there. I was one among many who worried about those priceless paintings and even the more priceless Hemingway manuscripts scattered around her apartment. Like that shopping bag with the Garden of Eden manuscript on the floor beneath the edge of a table, with a large ashtray and an assortment of liquor bottles perilously perched above. We all hoped they would be removed to the archive soon. But my concern the night of her much-anticipated last public talk was just keeping the speaking under the influence index reasonably favorable. With our bar distant table reserved, I hung up the phone and went into our living room where Mary and Sparrow were both playing guitars and sister singing folk songs. What's your pleasure, Mary? Another hour of rest here and then grab a bite to eat before your talk? Let's have a bite now, if we may. So Mary and I left Sparrow, who was driving to the lecture hall separately, to pick up the grad student crew that would help set up the reception after Mary's lecture. Mary and I entered the restaurant and were met by the maitre d', who started to lead us to our back corner table, but Mary said, I'm not hungry yet. Let's just sit here at the bar. So we sat at the bar and drank for about an hour, in depth, on empty stomachs, and we never did get any food. Mary had five or six very dry double or triple martinis. It was the first time I'd seen her shun her usual gin and tonics, and the mammoth martinis worried me a little, especially when she ordered two at a time. My poison of choice in those days was double Jack D on the rocks. I had two of those in the time that Mary consumed at least five of her killer martinis. We talked about travel, about New Orleans and Paris, about everything but her late husband. And then the clock swam into view, and I knew we had to leave to get over to campus for her talk. After my introduction, Mary took the podium and made some opening remarks about her life with Ernest. Then she talked for an hour, with no notes, about living under the London Blitz, holding her standing room only audience spellbound, and pleasing them even more after her talk was over, with the gracious acuity of her answer to questions from the audience. She got two standing ovations, the first when the talk ended, the second after the question and answer session. It was an exemplary performance in every respect. That night, she outdrank and outperformed me. She was in her late 60s, petite. I was in my mid-30s with more than twice her body mass, and in those days a reputation for drinking hard and handling it well. As my literary generation often says of the literary generation that preceded us, giants walked the earth in those days. For me, those elder giants included friends and mentors like James Dickey, Ellen Tate, Robert Penn Warren, and many others known for drinking mythically before performing admirably for their public. And in my witness knowing, Mary was of that company, that literary generation, any one of them likely to drink more than a busload of MFAs today and perform far more admirably. For decades now, I have been wary of speaking with interviewers and biographers about any of the Hemingway family and friends I've known, perhaps under the code that discretion is the better part of alcohol-fueled valor, or something like that, or really just the much more fundamental code that when it comes to friends, discretion is the rule. And when it comes to Mary Hemingway, any conversation, any biography, must deal with what many who knew her, as well as those who did not know her, characterizes her decline and disintegration into drunkenness and dementia. In my view, she was, during the years 1976 to 1980, more than competent and capable, indeed sometimes charming and witty, sometimes joyful, always faithful, and devoted to Ernest Hemingway's literary legacy. In those years, we had many good conversations. She invited me several times to Ernest's annual birthday party in Idaho. I never went, but I should have. Just as she, of all people, should have gone to the grand opening ceremony of the Hemingway Room at the Kennedy Library in July 1980. It was a grand occasion, as well as the first time I was truly troubled by the vicious gossip I heard about her. For example, she was too drunk, too incompetent to make the trip to Boston to celebrate the event that would not have happened without her. Without Mary Hemingway and her friend William Walton, and his friends the Kennedys, the most extraordinary literary archive in the United States would not exist. That 1980 ceremony was very fine, and I enjoyed my conversations with George Plimpton and Jacqueline Kennedy and other glitterati and Hemingway family members, and enjoyed meeting many others who would be my colleagues in the new generation of Hemingway scholars and critics. We also enjoyed the excellent wines and cognac that were served, and enjoyed taking surplus bottles back to Thompson Island with us on the boat. My only regret was that Mary was not there. By then I had become friends with Bill Walton, my seasonal neighbor in the Hudson Valley. He had inherited a remarkable old stone house in Stone Ridge, New York, 20 miles or so up the road from my place. We were friends and neighbors, and he was not, for me, a subject of academic inquiry, a source to be interviewed. Our friendship was anchored by our mutual love of gardening. From my garden, I took him rare varieties of French leeks and garlic, not just the harvest, but the seedlings and cloves for him to plant. From his garden, he gave me bulbs and cuttings to plant and bouquets of flowers to take home to Sparrow. We talked as much about clematis and azaleas and hollyhocks and leeks as we did about Hemingways and Kennedys. Oh, we talked about them, to be sure, and about Gertrude Stein, who had visited Bill's Aunt Emily at that very place, the historic stone tavern turned home, his aunt bequeathed him. In the dim light, he showed me letters from Stein to his aunt, and some letters to him from Ernest and Mary. When I told Bill that Hemingway's Nobel Prize medal was missing from the Cuban shrine to the Virgin Mary, where Hemingway had given it as a gift, an offering, and I had been told by a Chilean diplomat who knew Fidel Castro well that Fidel carried Hemingway's medal in his pocket as a good luck charm. Bill got excited and said, "We must get it back to its proper place." It became our cause in a kind of Mission Impossible way. I told Bill I would get to Cuba as soon as I could and investigate. And I did, but that's another story. But our deepest admiration was for Hemingway's work. Bill was not just an accomplished journalist and painter, but a good literary critic. I have a copy of one of his Hemingway books from his college days. In the margin, the young Bill Walton had written, "The secret of Hemingway's prose is this. It is often perfectly wrought blank verse." Because my interest in Hemingway was a matter of story and style, the art of fiction, I never interviewed Bill, but all through the 1980s, I told everybody who had Hemingway biographical inclinations and interests they had better talk to Bill Walton. I urged my friend Mike Reynolds, Hemingway's definitive biographer to date, to talk to Bill, and I even set up an extended visit, but it never happened. Finally, two interviews were recorded with Bill Walton shortly before his death in 1994. Bill was a great conversationalist and loved to gossip. When those interviews, much cited in this biography, were about to happen, Bill described them as academics, you know, and all do the usual hanseling and gretling, a few white pebbles, lots of breadcrumbs, and all that. In more than a decade of conversations with Bill, it became clear to me that he admired both Ernest and Mary, but his views had hardened as he aged. Mary was now just an old drunk and so forth. I saw Mary at least once in the early 80s after the 1980 Kennedy Library celebration that she missed, when she was quite lucid and witty and not drunk at all. And then in the summer of 1983, I went to see her as a kind of farewell visit because I was going abroad to live in France and then China for more than a year, and I feared she would be gone before I returned to the States. She was not lucid. Alfred Rice was there, doing surveillance and sentry duty. I have known many people who knew Alfred Rice, and I have never heard anyone say they liked him. I didn't. But the image that lingers from my last visit with Mary is the blankness in her eyes. I do not think she recognized me. By the time I settled back in the States a few years later, she was gone. In assessing a biography of someone you knew, a biography which draws on many source persons that you also knew, there are many intricacies and treacherous seas to navigate. The printed record, which is mostly what a biographer writing in the year 2021 has as a guide, is very different from the human record, the flesh and blood lived record. I must say that I cannot imagine any biographer navigating these waters better than Timothy Christian does here. And as for those I did not know personally, for example, the Buck and Pete Lanham situation, where treachery is the apt word, I am grateful for the acute, illuminating analysis provided in these pages, and I hope every student of Hemingway will pay close attention and adjust accordingly their views of Carlos Baker's biography. Again, I say, this book is a stunning achievement. It is the custom to say in these introductory remarks that this volume belongs on the bookshelves of every scholar and student and fan of Hemingway, and it does. That includes Hemingway aficionados like my neighbor, the bulldozer man. He will appreciate Timothy Christian's superb skills as a heavy equipment operator in biography, and I'm certain he will echo what I told him the other day. This is the Hemingway book we've all been waiting for so long. H.R. Stoneback, Distinguished Professor Emeritus, the State University of New York, President, past, the Ernest Hemingway Foundation and Society. Prologue. In August 1946, a famous writer and his wife, a former Time reporter, drove from Key West toward Sun Valley, Idaho. The back seat of their apple-green Lincoln convertible was packed with fishing gear and a couple of shotguns, a case of wine, and picnic hampers. Her portable typewriter was lodged between two large duffel bags stuffed with clothing, and there was no room left for anyone to sit. They planned to hunt in the hills and fish in the streams of the valleys of the Sawtooth Mountains. She was 3 months pregnant and wanted to be with her mother when the baby arrived. The couple talked excitedly about their expected child. Though he had 3 sons from 2 previous marriages, he longed for a daughter. They agreed to name a girl Bridget after her grandmother and a boy Thomas after her father. She made snacks of rye bread, cheese, and sliced onion, and they drank red wine from a bota as they drove from Florida to Louisiana, and then north and further west. She sang songs to amuse him, imitating Edith Piaf with her low alto voice, and they talked about the changes in scenery and accents and local habits. They stayed at roadside motels and ate in diners, exploring America from the road. When they reached Kansas, the temperature rose sharply, and they put up the top to find relief from the sun's searing rays. She sucked on chunks of ice, but felt dizzy. "Maybe it's my baby protesting the heat," she thought. 2 days later, having traveled through Nebraska, they reached a ramshackle motel in Casper, Wyoming. After a dinner of pork chops and mashed potatoes, they retired to their linoleum-floored room, and she fell into a deep sleep and dreamed of the sport of pig-sticking in India. She was riding a cantering horse, hunting for a pig to spear with her beribboned lance. Without warning, one of the other riders stabbed her in the stomach, and she fell from her horse and writhed, shrieking, on the ground. She woke from the nightmare to a burning pain in her belly, and he went to find a doctor and ambulance. It seemed to take forever for the ambulance to arrive, but when it did, a nurse gave her a pain-killing shot, and she lapsed into unconsciousness. When she woke 10 hours later, she saw her husband milking a plasma tube into a vein in her arm. He smiled at her and said, "Welcome back, kitten." She learned from the doctor and nurses that her husband had saved her life. One of her fallopian tubes had burst, and the resulting hemorrhage filled her abdomen with blood, like she was gutshot, with no place for the blood to go. Before he could operate, the surgeon had to inject plasma and blood to restore her fluid levels. When he tried to insert the intravenous needle, her veins collapsed, and he could not inject the life-saving liquid. It was hopeless. The surgeon said sorry and took off his gloves. He told the man to say goodbye. Instead, the husband took over. He told an assistant to cut an incision in her forearm so he could grab a vein. The cut was made, and the man pushed his finger and thumb into the slit in her flesh and managed, after several tries, to pinch a vein and pull it to the surface. He inserted the intravenous needle directly into the vein and squeezed on the sac of fluid, coaxing it into her. After one pack, she seemed to recover slightly, and he ordered the surgeon to operate at once. The man alternated plasma with pints of blood and fed them into his wife's arm. The surgeon opened her belly and sutured the ruptured fallopian tube. Over the next few hours, she hovered between life and death. When she came to, she saw her husband looking at her tenderly. He had refused to give up on her. She owed him her life, and he admired her courage. She kept going after pit bulls would have quit. He had never seen a stronger will to live, and the bond they formed that day was more robust than any wedding vow. As her father later remarked, they had discovered genuine friendship, the best thing, the most lasting thing in one's life. She was distressed to have lost the baby, but she loved her husband for saving her, and she hoped to become pregnant again. This could be a Hemingway short story, but it wasn't. Mary and Ernest forged an unbreakable friendship in the face of certain death. Ernest saved her life, and she thanked the fates he was with her in her time of danger. She forgave every misdeed and cruel act of the past and felt renewed faith in his love for her. Mary was beholden to Ernest and could never desert him, and Ernest felt responsible for her very being. 1. Chatting with Lords, 1904 to 1937. Mary Welsh was born and raised in the Paul Bunyan country of Minnesota. Oversized statues of the mythical giant lumberjack and his blue ox babe stand on Lake Bemidji's shore in the heart of Mary's hometown. This is the story of her escape from the land of lumberjacks. Mary's father, Thomas, was the son of Irish Protestant immigrants who settled in Lance, Michigan. Thomas saved enough money by working in logging camps to attend Valparaiso College for 1 year. He became a bookkeeper with a large logging company and entered the timber business on his own in 1904. That same year, 34-year-old Thomas married his childhood sweetheart, Adeline Beeler, the daughter of a miner and granddaughter of German immigrants from Baden. Adeline was feted at a party at her friend's house, which was prettily decorated with asparagus vine and carnations, and the guests, who were all office associates of Miss Beeler, were very enjoyably entertained with cards and music. A week later, Reverend J.M. Shank performed the marriage ceremony in the bride's home. The wedding was a very quiet affair, only relatives being present. The bride is accomplished and highly respected in this county, where she has lived most of her life. 35-year-old Adeline worked in the Department of State's office, and friends were sorry to see her leave the capital. Fellow workers said Thomas was the happiest man in town. The couple settled in Walker, Minnesota, in a log cabin on the shore of Leech Lake, named for the bloodsuckers that dwell along its shore. The population of Walker was 917, only 17 fewer persons than reside there today. Thomas harvested timber from the forests surrounding the lake, and his fortunes rose and fell with the volatile timber industry. His autobiography traces the trail he followed through millions of acres of pine-covered forest, always searching for something better to feed my hungry body and mind. Thomas befriended lumbermen, townsfolk, and members of the Chippewa tribe. He railed against rapacious logging practices and the theft of Indian lands. Ahead of his time, he advocated conservation measures, including the replanting of forested tracts. Thomas was a progressive thinker who got on well with the Chippewa people, respected their religious beliefs in the Great Manitou, and advocated on their behalf. Adeline was lonely in Walker and missed the social life of Lansing. Her favorite memory was of the 2 years she spent working in a state senator's office when her older brother chaperoned her at the city's fancy balls. Adeline's life changed on Sunday, April 5, 1908, when she gave birth to a healthy baby girl they named Mary after Thomas's mother. When Thomas heard Mary's first cry, a beautiful feeling of fatherhood came over me and a flood of love for you and your mother that seemed to come like a burst of sunshine from heaven. 2 years later, Adeline gave birth to a boy they named Otto after her brother. There must have been great joy, for Thomas wanted a son to help in his business. 8 months later, on a Sunday morning, Otto died after a week-long illness. Funeral services were held in the family home before interment at the Greenwood Cemetery. Adeline blamed their doctor for giving the baby the wrong medicine. She lost faith in doctors and became captivated by the teachings of Christian Science. In her home, reading religious tracts came to replace medical treatment. The family moved to the town of Bemidji when Mary was 6 so she could attend school. Thomas bought a large white house on the corner of Bemidji Avenue and 12th Street, which still stands, though it has been converted to apartments. Adeline maintained a neat, disciplined home filled with canned vegetables, fresh baked bread, and solid, if not exciting, food. Over the years, perhaps because of Thomas's frequent absences on business, Adeline became more involved in the Christian Science congregation. Mary remembered her mother as a proper Victorian lady who arranged her hair and attached her hat with pins before dressing for a weekly round of visits to other homes, where she left engraved calling cards. She also became active in the Charity Society and chaired the relief committee charged with helping people find work. Ads appeared in the Bemidji Pioneer inviting anyone needing assistance in finding work to phone Mrs. T.J. Welsh. Thomas incorporated the T.J. Welsh Land and Lumber Company to purchase timberlands, real estate, and wood products. He launched the paddle boat Northland to haul log booms, carry passengers on lake excursions, and transport cargo. A slowly rotating paddle wheel propelled the boat through the water at the dignified speed of 1 knot. From the age of 8, Mary spent her summers aboard the Northland with her father, cruising the waters of Leech Lake and exploring streams on camping trips in birch bark canoes. Thomas taught Mary to read the stars and talked to her about the meaning of justice and charity, illustrating his points with Bible stories and Shakespeare's plays. She learned to respect the Chippewa people who had been displaced from their lands by settlers moving westward. They liked my father because he never broke his word to them. A couple of times, our Indian friends saved us both from certain death, once by drowning, once by freezing. Thomas was no ordinary lumberjack. He had studied Shakespeare at Valparaiso College, learned Hamlet by heart, and wished he could have been an actor instead of a logger. He recited passages to his daughter as she sat with him in the Northland's wheelhouse on trips across Leech Lake. Mary joined as he sang Irish ballads in his rich baritone, learned his repertoire, developed a low alto voice, and loved singing for the rest of her life. Thomas became active in progressive Republican politics and was elected to attend state conventions. He read widely, wrote tracts for progressive causes, and in 1920 put himself forward as a candidate for Congress on the National Labor Party ticket. Mary opened her heart to her diary. "My father, nearly 6 feet tall, slim, wiry, quick in his movements, with his wavy auburn hair, long, straight nose, and quick, sharp blue eyes, was my biggest hero during all my childhood, and a hero always. Mary found him indomitable, valiant, and always ready to take a risk. She was grateful that he treated me both with attention and as an incipient adult. When the Northland moored for the night, its salon became an island of high culture in the backwoods of Minnesota. A wind-up phonograph played scratchy Mozart sonatas and Chopin piano concertos, the music wafting through screened windows into the night. Coal oil lamps cast a golden glow over the pine paneling and sparkled off the shiny brass barometer. Thomas and Mary sat in comfortable wicker chairs, reading from the ship's library, containing Shakespeare's complete works, volumes by Tolstoy and Galsworthy, and books borrowed from the Bemidji Library. Thomas cared about Mary's intellectual development and prepared her for the challenges she would face in a man's world. He treated his pretty, curly-haired daughter as an honorary boy, training her to be independent and self-confident. Two Chippewa boys, Bob Cloud and Jim Thunder, both twice Mary's age, became her summer friends. They called her Manny and taught her Chippewa phrases. One hot summer day, Bob fished from the lower deck of the Northland. He baited a hook with a piece of bacon and tied it to a string attached to a green willow stick. As Mary watched the line trailing in the water, Bob's rod bent, and he flung it upward. A shiny brown-green pickerel flopped on the deck beside us. Bob picked it up by its tail, bashed its head against the deck, and it lay there inert. Except for flies, I had not seen many creatures killed. Mary took her consternation to her father in the wheelhouse. It was so alive and shining, and then so quick it was dead, and the shine faded. Her father nodded. "Let's let things live, Papa. I don't shine, but I like living." Mary could not bear the killing of animals, even for food, and eventually became a conservationist, like Thomas, who refused to hunt for deer because he did not like killing them. During the winter, Mary practiced Chopin etudes and accompanied the Sunday school choir. In March 1920, she played Beethoven's piano solo, Minuet in G, for the Women's Study Club. On a Sunday in November that same year, Mary went to the church early to practice an unfamiliar hymn. She overheard a heated argument between her mother and a Sunday school teacher, each claiming to be in charge of the Sunday school. Mary was disturbed by the hypocrisy of her mother and the other lady. How could they teach children to love and respect their neighbors when they did not? When she got home, 12-year-old Mary announced she was resigning from Sunday school. Her mother protested, saying she was being cruel and breaking her heart, but Mary would not relent and never went to Sunday school again. Mary came to prefer her father's world, filled with outdoor adventures, music, reading, and reflection. Her mother focused on household chores and centered her social life around the Christian Science congregation in Bemidji. Mary's expectations for male behavior owed much to the standards she observed in her youth. Her father treated her with respect, encouraged her to see the wider world, and fostered her ambition to write. Mary could not have had a more secure foundation than her father's love. His unwavering support created an inner expectation that all men would adore her. Thomas Welsh continued to be proud of Mary, and he cheered her climb through the male-dominated field of journalism. After he retired, Thomas taught himself to type, and he wrote short stories, completed an autobiography, and drafted political tracts supporting progressive causes. He enjoyed a glass of Irish whiskey, but controlled his intake. Mary's memoir pays tribute to her father and the lessons he taught her. While she felt love from her mother and appreciated her kindness, she did not want to become like her, trapped in a small house in a remote town. Carl Sandburg's poem Chicago was published when Mary was 6 years old, and she read it several times in her youth. His homage to the city, with lifted head, singing so proud to be alive and coarse and strong and cunning, pulled her like gravity. She knew she had to leave Bemidji, the soft little city of her childhood, and face the strong, husky, brawling reality of Chicago. in grade school, influenced by the Bemidji Pioneer editor who often dined with her parents, Mary decided to become a journalist. This was an unusual ambition for a young girl in those times, but the courage of the suffragettes succeeding in getting the vote for women inspired 12-year-old Mary. In grade 8, she received first prize for the use of correct words, and finding the right word became an obsession for the rest of her writing life. After graduating from high school, Mary spent a year at the Bemidji Teachers College. Then she persuaded her parents to send her to the journalism program at Northwestern University in Evanston, just north of the city of her dreams. Professor Melville Herskovitz, a noted American anthropologist, inspired her with his lectures about the trading economies and culture of West Africa. He opened her eyes to the world beyond her small town and raised issues of ethnic and racial equality in America. Herskovitz created a hunger for travel to far-off places to discover and question, understand and describe. Mary attracted male attention and flitted from boy to boy, taking none of them seriously. At Northwestern, she fell in love with a drama student who won her heart with his poetic eyes and gentle manner. Larry Cook drove her to meet his parents in Ohio, and on their way they found a justice of the peace who married them in his sitting room on May 30, 1930. Mary had just turned 22, and they soon realized they had very different expectations for their lives. Mary found her husband selfish and self-centered. He was not solicitous of her as her father had been, and her first marriage ended almost as casually as it had begun, without rancor or nastiness. The Great Depression, which began in 1929, devastated the timber industry, and Thomas could no longer afford to support Mary in college. She took part-time catering jobs, serving the wealthier students, but she questioned the value of a college degree and decided it made more sense to get a job in journalism. In 1930, she dropped out of Northwestern to edit a trade journal, The American Florist. Mary worked long hours and stayed for 2 years, earning $75 a week. She impressed the publisher, who wrote a laudatory letter of reference, noting she capably and competently disposed of every division of her work and unsparingly disregarded the hours involved. In 1932, Mary became a reporter for a company that published 5 weekly neighborhood newspapers on Chicago's North Side. Later that year, she landed a job at the Chicago Daily News, and her dream of becoming a journalist came closer. Mary wanted an ordinary reporter's position, but was assigned to the Society Department under its imperious editor, Miss Leola Ellard, who tried to make the women's pages the finest in the country. Mary recalled, "She had a voice that was frequently irritating. You could hear her from quite a distance, and work used to stop when Leola had someone on the carpet. I think she really felt a day in which no tears were evoked from someone on her staff was a worthless day." Mary's colleague, Adeline Fitzgerald, described the Society pages as a young department, and Mary was our baby. She was little and elfin and cute, with extraordinarily small, neat ears, which the women's editor alternately praised and pinned back. Her fluffy, yellow dandelion head survived, where weightier heads fell. Stamina, we called it. The reporters worked long hours, and Mary learned to write under pressure and became braver. She adopted the nom de plume of Margot Jr. and wrote a daily column reporting on Chicago's society weddings and dinner parties. Her friend Sarah Boyden remembered, within a few months she knew more people in Chicago society than did many of its members. Mary cut her curly hair very short and achieved an aureoled appearance, much more striking than the more conventional bob she had worn before. Lester Hemingway, the famous author's younger brother, was also a reporter at the Chicago Daily News. Though Lester was 7 years younger than Mary, they became friends, and she went out sailing with him a few times. In his memoir, Lester recalled, "Mary was a cheerful petite blonde from Minnesota who kept her stockings nicely pulled up and liked to sit on a desk swinging her legs while she talked. Fascinated by Ernest, she would say, 'Gee, it must be wonderful to have a famous brother. Come on, tell us about him.'" Mary read everything Ernest wrote, and she pestered Lester to tell her about his older brother. In the spring of 1936, just after her 28th birthday, Mary spent her life savings on a ticket, boarded a steamer in Montreal, and made her way to London. She wandered the streets of London and fell in love with the city. Days later, in Paris, after an all-night toot on the left bank, Mary lunched with journalists who told her stories of the impending war with Germany. Mary decided on the spot that she wanted to stay and report on the action. One of her new friends gave her the telephone number for Canadian millionaire Max Aitken, known by his formal title, Lord Beaverbrook, who owned several British newspapers. Mary had nothing to lose and phoned the Beaver the following morning. "I just called him up as though I were in the habit of hanging on international telephones and chatting with lords." Mary talked fast, and the idea that a young woman would travel from Paris to meet him persuaded the Beaver to grant a 15-minute interview. "I dug up practically my last cent and flew to London to visit the greatest newspaper tycoon in the world. He turned out to be a genuinely friendly guy." Mary made it to his home for 4 o'clock tea, and they had a brief chat about her wish to be a London-based journalist covering the coming war. He dismissed the idea there would be a war, but told her to see the editor of his Daily Express, then the largest circulation English-language daily newspaper in the world. The butler called a cab, and Mary shot to Fleet Street, where the editor informed her that as he already had an American girl on staff, he had no use for another. Defeated and deflated, Mary boarded a ship to New York the next day. She wrote to the Beaver, thanked him for his consideration, and asked him to remember her if a vacancy arose. Mary returned to her old beat, covering dog shows and murder trials, Gold Coast weddings and raids on burlesque houses. The arbitrary rule of Leola Allard seemed all the more aggravating. Mary tried to persuade the managing editor to give her a chance to work in the Paris or London bureaus. He noted her deficiency in French and said the man in London was doing an excellent job on his own. Mary spent a frustrating winter working at the paper, but in the spring her luck turned. Lord Beaverbrook's secretary called to say the Beaver was in Chicago, and he invited Mary to dine with him in his private suite that very evening. She agreed to meet him for lunch the next day at the Drake Hotel. A series of lunches and dinners followed, and it emerged that the old man was smitten with Mary. He was almost twice her age and asthmatic. His grand head rested on a weak body, and his legs were like sticks, and though Mary was not attracted to him, he was relentless. Mary kept asking him to find a place for her on the staff of the London Daily Express. Perhaps to further his pursuit of Mary, the Beaver shared his philosophy of how a young woman ought to advance her career in Europe. Nothing would be gained through innocence or virtue. Instead, a young woman should realize her path would be easier if she had a powerful man as her sponsor and supporter. And how to find such a supporter? She must learn how to please men and bring those secrets to the bed of her sponsor. Her influence would grow and her career would blossom. Romantic love was a waste of time. The Beaver's pale blue eyes sparkled as he imparted this advice. In her memoir, Mary said the Beaver did not change her mind. Many years later, Mary counseled Valerie Hemingway that to be a successful female journalist, it was advantageous to sleep your way to the top. I found that very amusing. It had not been any of the handbooks I had consulted. Whether Mary took her own advice in the case of Lord Beaverbrook, we cannot say. Before Beaverbrook returned to England, he tried to persuade Mary to accompany him on a trip up the Nile, but she declined and pressed him for a real job. He agreed that if she came to London, he would help find her work. Mary didn't trust the Beaver, but she took a risk, sold her furniture, and scraped together enough money for a one-way ticket across the Atlantic. The Beaver invited her to lunch at his country estate in Surrey and offered her a job in one of his three papers. She chose the Daily Express and turned up for work on July 2, 1937, the same day the world learned Amelia Earhart had disappeared over the Pacific. The editor asked Mary to write a 1,000-word piece about Earhart's misadventure. Despite the Daily Express's grand facade, the newsroom was cramped, and Mary shared a rough plank table with four other reporters. They covered news in London and the country south of Birmingham. Her favorite assignments were those needing pictures when she was able to travel with the friendly photographers in their cars. Driving through the countryside, she learned about rural England over pints of beer and bangers and mash in village pubs. Mary also enjoyed her social life in London, partying with fellow reporters and lunching at the pubs surrounding the Express's offices.
An Australian journalist, Noel Monks, began paying attention to her. He was bulky but fit from his swimming days in Australia and carried his large frame in well-pressed suits. His bullet-shaped head was prematurely gray and his ruddy face cleanly shaved. Noel extended a protective shield around Mary, which she found comforting and attractive. He was stern and ponderous, but Mary discovered his gentle, private side. Noel had an underlying lack of confidence because he had stuttered as a child. Even as a young reporter, Noel continued to stammer, and when he got excited, he stuttered until he could settle down. Though only 31, Noel was already a seasoned war correspondent. He had reported on the Italian invasion of Ethiopia in 1935 and was the first correspondent to reach Guernica after the Germans firebombed the Basque town on April 26, 1937. Noel reported in the Daily Express, "I walked this evening through the still-burning town. Hundreds of bodies were found in the debris. Most were charred beyond recognition. At least 200 others were riddled with machine gun bullets as they fled to the hills." He estimated, "Of the 4,000 bombs dropped by the raiders, 1,000 were incendiary, and 1,000 were aerial torpedoes." Noel was haunted for weeks by the sight of the blackened bodies of 50 women and children huddled together in a cellar. He told Mary they thought they had found a safe refuge, but the fires burned them alive. Mary felt sickened by this story, and it fed her hatred of fascism. Mary had come a long way from the backwoods of Minnesota to the cosmopolitan diversions of London. Exhilarated to be in the center of things, she was happy to be dating a famous foreign correspondent who shared stories of his adventures.
2. You May Sleep Quietly, September 1938 till June 1940. As Mary and Noel dated, the war came closer and interrupted their lives.
In late September 1938, the Express sent Mary to Munich to report on Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain's meeting with Hitler, Mussolini, and Daladier of France.
She watched the crowds chanting, "Heil, Heil," as Hitler drove slowly to the meeting in an open car. He responded with a hand wave that looked bored, languid, foppish. The next morning, Chamberlain waved to cheering crowds from the balcony of the Feuerbau. The people of Munich did not want war and yelled, "Heil, Chamberlain!" After further talks that afternoon, Chamberlain called a press conference in his suite. Mary watched him, wearing a scraggly mustache and stiff wing collar, announce in his posh accent that Britain and France had agreed to Hitler's demand for the Sudetenland's annexation in exchange for a treaty of peace. Chamberlain flew back to England, and cheering crowds greeted him as he read the letter he and Hitler had signed, promising to never go to war again. Later, Chamberlain appeared in the window of 10 Downing Street to greet the happy crowds and utter the infamous words, "You may sleep quietly. It is peace for our time." After Mary reported the news of Chamberlain's Munich press conference, the Express ordered her to the Czech border to observe the German occupation of the Sudetenland. She crossed the Danube and saw columns of German troops waiting for orders 2 miles from the border. The German major commanding the operation greeted Mary graciously and sent her to a country house where she could wait until they finished the process. His refined manners underlined her powerlessness and made her feel hopeless. She shared her anger toward Chamberlain with her friend, Herbie Clark. "This anger runs along my nerves and brain like a flame. Fury at the injustice toward the Czechs. Fury that Chamberlain runs his country into God knows what shame without giving them a chance to speak, even in Parliament." Mary said she had transformed from a violent pacifist into a violent fighter. "That's what's happened to most of the people around here. The things they said about Chamberlain infuriated her. Hell's delight if thoughts could kill. He made me sick at my stomach this morning, repudiating all responsibility for everything." A week later, Mary returned to London and Noel. They had been dating for a year, and they married at the registry office in Chelsea Town Hall on December 31st, 1938. Noel was 32 and divorced from his former wife, Susan, with whom he had a son, John, and Mary was 29. For many months of their courtship, Noel had failed to mention to Mary that he had a son from his first marriage. When he later apologized for this oversight, he told Mary the boy meant nothing to him and never would. Noel was a mild-mannered man who abstained from drink and delighted in provisioning their marital nest. Mary told her parents she enjoyed being called Mrs. Monks. They moved into a small house in Chelsea with gilt chairs and red velvet cushions and carpets, and from the upstairs windows they could look into a walled garden bright with flowers and singing birds. On Sundays they slept until noon and finished their breakfast at 3:30 p.m. They read the Sunday papers, went for walks in Hyde Park, and watched children feeding the swans on the beach of the Serpentine. Walking home arm in arm, they talked about the future. Noel wanted Mary to move with him to Australia, but she wanted to return to the States to be close to her mother when they eventually had children. Meanwhile, the war grew closer and threatened to pull them apart. In March 1939, Chamberlain promised the Polish government that if the Germans attacked Poland, the British and French governments would immediately provide all necessary support to the invaded country. Beaverbrook warned against the guarantee to Poland, but Chamberlain ignored his advice. In April, the British government instituted compulsory military service. Over the following weeks, Mary's reports in the Daily Express sketched London's poor and powerless as they prepared for war. Mary interviewed Mrs. Edith Spong, who decorated her ARP, Air Raid Protection Shelter, with curtains and a toy elephant on the roof. Mrs. Spong said, "We will be live sardines, tin and all. It doesn't look big enough to hold us all." A photo showed a large woman holding a small child on her knee in the doorway of a tiny corrugated shed. Mary reported on four young unmarried couples who were blazing with indignation because their landlord would not permit them to build an ARP shelter in their back garden. The landlord refused to tear up the paved terrace. "Who will pay to replace the tarmac?" he asked. One of the young women appeared less angry and more fatalistic, asking, "But are these shelters so important? Would they really save us if one of the big bombs dropped on the street?" Mary's stories capture the spirit and humanity of the people she met. In May 1939, the Express dispatched Noel to Gibraltar and Tangier to cover the German fleet in the Mediterranean, then to Morocco to report on France's preparedness. Next, he covered the Spanish camps at Perpignan, France, where some 300,000 refugees from Franco's fascism lived, forgotten by the world. Then they sent him to Jerusalem to report on the chaos in Palestine. Finally, the Express assigned him to Cyprus and the British General Headquarters for Middle East Land Forces. Meanwhile, Mary continued to write prosaic stories about life in London. In late June, she met Sam Cotton, a pensioner from the Isle of Wight, who had traveled to London to present a petition requesting an increase in the old age pension. Afterward, he drank tea at the Houses of Parliament. "A very nice tea, this," he said. "I think it's costing more than I have to live on in a week. Such a lot." The Express ordered Noel back to London, and the couple took a romantic vacation on the wide sandy beaches of France's Saint-Jean-de-Luz, the fashionable resort town. They spent hours lying in the sand and playing in the surf. A giant seawall, started by Napoleon but finished 30 years later, protected the port from violent Atlantic storms. The rolling surf lapped at the edge of the town, and Mary thought it spectacular compared to Bemidji and the bloodsucker-infested beaches of Leech Lake. They ate fresh seafood brought to restaurants by the flotilla of fishing boats moored in Port de Pêche, strolled along plane tree-lined streets, walked to the lighthouse, and retreated to their bed. They tried their luck in the casino and took a car to Biarritz to dine in splendor and play baccarat at the magnificent Hotel du Palais, frequented by the Spanish aristocracy since the Civil War. The next move in the international chess game came on August 24, 1939, when Stalin signed a non-aggression pact with Hitler's foreign minister. The agreement paved the way for Hitler's attack on Western Europe, for he knew the Russian bear on his eastern flank would remain in hibernation. Hitler could now fight a one-front war, and only 12 days of peace remained. On Friday, September 1st, the BBC reported German troops had crossed the Polish border. The Luftwaffe firebombed Warsaw, using the same brutal technique they had perfected at Guernica's expense. Chamberlain's promise of peace for our time became a naive failure to appease Hitler's ruthless ambition. Mary waited in Downing Street for a reaction from the Prime Minister's office. None came. Instead, Chamberlain went to the House of Commons that evening to deliver an ultimatum. The Germans were to withdraw their troops from Poland, or the British government would fulfill its obligation to Poland. The Germans did not reply. That afternoon, Noel's editor summoned him to Fleet Street. "Monks, we will be at war on Sunday. The War Office and Air Ministry have asked us for names of two correspondents to represent us. I have put you down for the RAF. Is that all right?" Noel was delighted and took a taxi to Moss Brothers to buy a tailor-made uniform. 2 days later, at 11 a.m. on Sunday, September 3rd, 1939, just as Mary was preparing breakfast, Chamberlain came on the radio to announce that, given the German failure to comply with the British ultimatum, a state of war was in effect. A week later, Noel set off for Reims in the heart of France's Champagne country. He stayed at the luxurious Lion d'Or, next to the suite the Duke and Duchess of Windsor used when they visited the front. For the next 7 months of what became known as the Phony War, that period between the declaration of war by the United Kingdom and the German invasion of France, Noel covered the operations of the RAF's Advanced Air Striking Force, made up of two British squadrons of Hurricane fighters. They were to hit the German forces when and if they entered France. The French were optimistic about repelling a German invasion, believing the system of defensive positions making up the Maginot Line would protect them. Noel found the French attitude appalling, and he told Mary the Maginot Line was the biggest hoax of the war because the guns pointed in the wrong direction. Several correspondents wrote pieces critical of the Maginot Line, and one suggested they should strengthen fortifications at Sedan, the very place where the Germans would soon enter France. French censors deleted all references to the vulnerability of French defenses. Using Noel's connections, Mary traveled to join him in France to report on the British Expeditionary Force's living conditions. During Christmas 1939, the much-loved Gracie Fields, decorated by the King for her services to entertainment and recuperating from cervical cancer, came to entertain the troops. Officers not invited, only petty officers, Tommies, and aircraft maintenance crews could come. Spirits ballooned. Mary and Noel watched Gracie's inspired performance at the Reims Opera House. After the show, soldiers climbed into lorries and hundreds of voices sang, "Roll out the barrel," as they drove home in the frosty air. Little did they suspect that 5 months later, they would be on the verge of extinction on the beaches of Dunkirk. In January, Mary returned to London to interview the American ambassador to Britain, Joseph Kennedy Sr., the future president's father. Having returned from a visit to Germany, he didn't believe the French and English could hold out against the mighty German forces, and Kennedy encouraged appeasement. Mary filed a story describing the ambassador's view, but editors eviscerated her piece, stifling the unwelcome news that the American ambassador did not believe Britain could defend herself. Mary persuaded the Daily Express to send her back to France, and she found a pleasant flat in Paris, near Les Invalides. She enrolled in French classes, spent time at the Ritz Bar meeting journalists, and wrote pieces she considered merely decorative. The French officials she interviewed seemed oblivious to the threat posed by Germany and deflected questions. During that spring, Mary met a fellow journalist, Kenneth Coyenne, at the French language class for foreigners given by the Alliance Française at the Sorbonne. Coyenne provided a snapshot of Mary. Rather stocky at about 5'2", she had brown hair, blue eyes, sharp features, and a self-assured manner. Coyenne and Mary nodded each other during the classes, but they did not chat, instead giving their attention to the instructor, who spoke English as well as she spoke French. Mary thought the French were living in denial of the German menace. Meanwhile, she and Noel visited between Reims and Paris, and she felt secure when she was with him. The French illusion of security imploded on May 10, 1940, when the Germans began a thorough and devastating bombing campaign against the Allies in France. German forces executed a rapid attack at Sedan, the weakest point of the French defenses, and drove to the Channel, encircling and trapping British troops. The Luftwaffe vastly outnumbered Knowles hurricane squadrons, which retreated deeper into France, and the correspondents left their comfortable lodgings in Reims and followed the squadron south. Over the next month, the German attack became relentless, and they pushed the British expeditionary force closer to the sea. When France's defenses collapsed, the British had to save themselves, abandoning their equipment and evacuating Dunkirk in hundreds of small civilian boats.
In 4 days, from May 28th to May 31st, 1940, some 350,000 troops retreated to Britain.
Noel visited Mary in Paris on June 10th. They dined with friends at the elegant Cascade in Le Bois, and Mary and her friends enjoyed two bottles of an exquisite Chateau Mouton Rothschild. Noel drank only water. They could hear the rumble of massive artillery explosions in the distance as the fighting came closer. Taking a cab back to Mary's flat, they saw convoys of trucks loaded with file cabinets and office equipment abandoning the City of Light. The French government was pulling out of Paris, and they realized the time to leave had arrived.
Mary packed in 20 minutes, leaving most of her clothes, books, and all her grandmother's silver in the care of her landlady.
They caught a taxi to Gare Austerlitz and ran down the platform alongside the train, already filled to bursting with desperate Parisians fleeing the city. Finding space on the last coach, Mary sat in her suitcase next to a spaniel and his old master, who had been a curator at the Louvre. Mary and Noel got off at the city of Blois, in central France, where the French government planned to reestablish itself. They found a hotel and spent a restless night. In the morning, it became apparent the collapsing French government would move to Bordeaux. Mary saw no reason to stay in Blois and found a ride to Biarritz with a wealthy American woman she had befriended in Paris. Noel stayed behind. After an arduous drive, Mary arrived at the coastal resort town of Biarritz and found a pleasant hotel near the central square. Suffering from a cold and fever, she slept for 2 days. On the third day, she strolled the beach and watched the relentless waves break against the ancient rocks. Eons of crashing water had carved them into jagged sculptures, standing in the turquoise sea, surrounded by salty spray. Mary walked to the Hotel du Palais, lingered at the outdoor café, sipped an espresso, smoked a few cigarettes, and watched the pounding waves. She had abandoned all her worldly goods in Paris and realized she might as well get back to London. A man at the next table told her a few ships were still carrying passengers from Bordeaux to England, and this might be the last chance to escape from the German troops. Late that afternoon, Noel arrived, his clothes caked with dust and his eyes bloodshot from lack of sleep. Mary felt relieved to see his smiling face through the stubble of his gray beard. He told her about walking the roads to Biarritz, clogged with refugees carrying all they had. After Noel cleaned up, they walked to a restaurant and bumped into the same man who had driven them several times from Saint-Jean-de-Luz to the casinos in Biarritz the year before. Luckily, they had tipped him well, and he agreed to drive them to Bordeaux for only twice the regular tariff. The following day, they arrived in Bordeaux and found the city teeming with people desperate to escape the Nazis. Mary and Noel managed to buy tickets on the last ship to leave Bordeaux, the Madura. Over 1,600 people jammed the small steamer designed to carry 250 passengers, among them many of the journalists Mary and Noel had befriended in London and France, plus the staff of the British Embassy. They stood at the rail, watching nervously as the boat cleared the harbor while bombs fell around them. The Madura zigzagged for 5 days and nights to avoid torpedoes. Despite the ever-present risk, Mary slept well on the deck, under the stars, on an air mattress provided by a generous crewman.
On June 25, 1940, the Madura, escorted by a British destroyer, reached Falmouth's quiet harbor. The ordered greenery of England never looked so hospitable and comforting, verdant hills sloping down to the neat town of Falmouth, as it did that June morning when we drew into the quiet harbor. 3. It would be just like that bloody Hitler to try his invasion on Christmas. July 1940 until November 1941. Mary was delighted to be back among the feisty Londoners and away from the depressed, surrendering French. She found a flat in their old Chelsea neighborhood, and Mary resumed shopping with her local butcher, greengrocer, and provisioner. Despite the rationing and frugality, Mary felt at home. On the zigzagging Madura, Mary had decided it would be better if she reported for an American rather than a British newspaper. Shocked by the speed of the German advance, she felt the urgency of persuading her fellow citizens to come to Britain's aid. Nearly all of the correspondents I knew held similar estimates of England's desperate plight, Mary recalled, and hoped by their dispatches to indicate to the American people that they must take the honorable risk and quickly send the British help. Mary phoned Walter Grabner, the bureau chief for Time magazine in London, with whom she had worked at the Daily News in Chicago. Grabner regarded Mary so highly he asked her to come in at once, but she wanted a day off to arrange her things. On July 10, 1940, she began working at Time's offices in Dean Street, Soho, the first day of the air war over Britain. The Time offices were at 2-4 Dean Street, just off Oxford Street, in an undistinguished red brick five-story building now converted to a Tesco Express grocery store. Further down the street sits the French House, a bar that served as the unofficial headquarters of General Charles de Gaulle and the French Resistance in London. At the Daily Express, each reporter wrote and filed stories published under their byline. Time's formula was different because it was a weekly magazine rather than a daily paper. Time reporters sent in their material by cable, and editors rewrote the cablees and blended it with wire service reports to create a coherent story covering the past week. The magazine stories were usually combined efforts, and Time published few pieces with bylines. Despite this policy, Time Life published several articles during the war under the byline Mary Welsh. Mary contributed to many stories about the threatened German invasion. Time reported the Nazis aimed to close the coast of southeast England to British shipping. German submarines attacked convoys and docks, and massive German bombing raids trapped British airplanes on the ground. Convinced an invasion was imminent, British authorities evacuated all women, children, and foreigners from areas within 20 miles of the coast. Winston Churchill replaced Chamberlain as Prime Minister, and he concluded that to stop the German invasion, the British needed to achieve air superiority. He appointed Lord Beaverbrook as Minister of Aircraft Production in his National Coalition Government. Time approved the appointment of the bumptious, result-getting, self-made man, Lord Beaverbrook, the impish 146-pound owner of the London Daily Express. Mary worked on the Time cover story about Beaverbrook, published on September 16, 1940. She toured aircraft and ammunition factories and interviewed the men in charge. Then she visited the Beaver at his office on the embankment. As he escorted Mary through his outer office, past rows of male secretaries, he asked in a loud voice, "And tell me, is your husband giving you sexual satisfaction?" Mary supposed the Beaver wanted to embarrass her because he had not forgiven her for refusing to cruise the Nile with him. The cover story asserted, "Even if Britain goes down, it will not be Beaverbrook's fault. If she holds out, it will be his triumph. This is a war of machines. It will be won on the assembly lines." The story lauded the Beaver's unconventional but effective methods. By nagging, harrying, wheedling, the Beaver got underlings to assume responsibility. The appointment of an unelected, boasting, ghost little man from the colonies to a position second only to Churchill was as unbelievable, even to the Beaver himself, as if they had appointed him the Archbishop of Canterbury. Throughout Britain, civilians trained in self-defense, preparing to defend their homeland. Mary joined a women's rifle brigade and drilled with them until she lost interest because they couldn't practice with live ammunition, which was being saved for the real war. The fear of invasion was palpable, and the saleswoman in Mary's greengrocer's shop kept a long knife under a folded newspaper next to the coin box. "If I ever meet one of those Germans, I'll swish his head off," she said, lifting the paper and showing Mary her weapon. In August and September, the Germans launched massive daylight raids, first targeting naval bases and coastal air defenses, then RAF bases and aircraft factories. Mary traveled to the bomb sites to report on the damage. She recalled Londoners slept in the underground, where at least the noise of the bombs and AK-AK guns was muffled. Some nights, when she had worked late and Soho was the primary target, those few of us left in our office who still lived in London moved down to the pellets in the airless shelter of our building in Dean Street. Mary remembered, "I only slept there once. Walking home through the noise was so much preferable to public sleeping." Hitler's Operation Sea Lion, the plan for invading Britain, assumed German mastery of the air over the English Channel to protect invasion barges ready to depart along the Dutch and Belgium coasts. The Luftwaffe began daylight raids to wear down the RAF in a war of attrition. Relying on neutral experts, Time reported the Germans had twice as many bombers and fighter planes as the British. The Germans had 11,000 pilots, the British only 7,000. While RAF pilots flew back-to-back missions, the Germans took a full day's rest after each day of flying. Time concluded, on paper, the outcome looked inevitable, only a matter of time. The Germans planned the invasion for September, assuming the Luftwaffe would have achieved air superiority by then. On August 16th, 2,500 German planes attacked the London docks and munition stores near Tilbury on the southwest, killing 1,000 civilians. 2 days later, they flew up the Thames estuary and attacked London again, endangering the city's water supply. Mary filed reports detailing the death and destruction. The Germans launched daylight raids of 1,800 to 2,000 planes in the following days. As German losses grew, they reduced the flight size, deploying 1,000 planes a day in groups of 50 or 60 aircraft at a time. The Luftwaffe expected the constant pressure would cause the collapse of the British forces. However, as Time reported, railway lines suffered no significant dislocation. And Lord Beaverbrook claimed the production of fighters and bombers had reached an all-time high. On September 6, the British bombed Berlin. This tactic surprised and enraged the Germans, and they stopped bombing radar stations and air bases and began attacking London. The German response allowed the British to repair their air bases, and by September 12th, most of the airfields were operational, and many of the aircraft had been replaced. The civilians of London now lived on the front line of the war, and Mary wrote about the impact of the bombing on a typical Londoner. "The crudest, most cruel, and least effective attacks of the Nazi Luftwaffe have been in its indiscriminate bombing of the homes and properties of the people of Britain." Mary told of Mrs. Lillian Hart and her husband George, who lived in the working-class district of Bethnal Green in the city's East End. George, a cabinet maker since he was 14, had made all the furniture in their flat. After attending the National Day of Prayer, Lillian walked down the road with her dog Jip to meet George coming home from work. As the church bell rang 8 o'clock, an air raid siren wailed, and she rushed back to her flat to show people the way to the shelter under the vicarage. She heard a screamer coming down, and then another, and another. After sending Jip upstairs to the kitchen to hide under the table where he stayed during raids, Lillian ran back to the shelter and stood inside. She heard a dull thud, followed by a giant explosion. A shower of broken glass fell around her, but miraculously she escaped injury. Children screamed, and a woman moaned in the debris. Lillian scrambled to the shelter's front door to help the people coming in. Glancing up, she saw her flat was gone. The sky appeared where her bedroom had been. Feeling numb, she went looking for her cat, Timmy, and Jip. She returned to work at the shelter until late that night, when George came. They embraced and looked over the pile of rubble that had been their home. In the morning, Lillian looked for Timmy. She found her black pleated skirt, slashed and torn, hanging from a bush on the other side of the vicarage. She spotted their ration cards and a pair of pajamas George had just bought, still in the cellophane wrapper. Losing the flat and all the furniture he had crafted devastated George, and Lillian tried to comfort him, saying they could start again. Amid the rubble, they turned up the biscuit tin holding all their savings. They found Jip's body draped over a rafter, but discovered no trace of Timmy. The Luftwaffe launched two massive bombing raids on London on September 15, 1941, now commemorated as Battle of Britain Day. The Germans believed the RAF lay crushed on the brink of defeat, but British pilots were rested. Crews had repaired their aircraft, and Bomber Command brought in squadrons from around the country to defend London. The first wave of about 250 bombers arrived over the Channel just before noon. Swarms of RAF Hurricanes and Spitfires attacked, breaking up bomber formations, allowing only about half to deliver their bombs over the city. The rest of the bombers scattered and dropped their loads over a wider area, doing less damage than intended. A second wave came in the early afternoon, and the attacking Spitfires and Hurricanes again broke up the formations. Harried by the pursuing fighters, the bomber crews dropped their loads at random, hoping to lighten their aircraft and make a safe retreat across the Channel. In an optimistic account of the conflict, the Daily Telegraph reported the RAF destroyed 175 German planes but lost only 30. These figures proved to be incorrect, but did wonders for morale. As Time later reported, the Germans lost 61 aircraft and the RAF lost 31 fighters. The RAF had managed a 2-to-1 kill ratio. Since the dogfights took place over Britain, police or citizens captured downed German pilots. British pilots who had to bail out or crash land could return to duty. Churchill visited Bomber Command's bunker at the height of the battle and observed that all the squadrons were flying. Churchill asked Air Vice Marshal Keith Park, "What other reserves have we?" Park replied, "There are none." There was not one squadron left in reserve. The war of attrition settled in Britain's favor that day, and the Luftwaffe never had the strength to launch another massive daylight raid. Operation Sea Lion was postponed. However, the Germans had sufficient power to bomb London each night from October 1940 until May 1941. The Blitz was terrifying, but did not break the will of the British people. Mary and her friends had plenty of close calls during the extended bombings. One evening, Mary walked home alone from the Savoy in a fine new black suit. When she got to her flat and looked in the mirror, the suit was gray. It was a night of incendiaries. I had flung sandbags on a couple of them that were burning along my way, and had thrown myself prone on the pavement 5 times during a mile or more when the descending screamers sounded too close. A few nights later, Mary and Noel enjoyed drinks at home with 3 RAF friends when the air raid siren sounded and anti-aircraft guns started firing. The young men left for a club, and Mary began undressing for bed. She heard the scream of an incoming bomb and rushed into the hallway, just as an explosion blasted shards of glass through the curtains in her bedroom. The electricity went off. Noel found a flashlight, and they went down 2 floors to the mattresses kept under the stairs for such a night. In the morning, Mary tasted dust in her mouth, and her eyes were red and stinging. A fine layer of combined dust and ash coated everything in the house. Burglar alarms sounded in the neighborhood, and fires burned on the horizon. When the bombing stopped, the resulting inconveniences proved intolerable. Everything was a mess. However, Mary grew closer to her neighbors through the shared experiences, and they managed with good humor and small kindnesses. One night, a fragment of shrapnel blew through the window and sliced through Mary's earlobe before blasting apart a sugar bowl. Mary saved the sugar before tending to her ear. She felt terrified as she realized how close death had come. When Mary interviewed ordinary Londoners to assess the Blitz's effect on morale, she found stubborn pride and resilience, and she wrote a story for Time about Blitz business. She reported, "The measure of British sang-froid and the business-as-usual spirit in London was shown by a crowd of several hundred women shoppers. They rushed for bargains at one of the big West End stores. At the same time, firefighters were digging through tons of debris in frantic efforts to release 200 clerks entombed in the basement the night before by a bomb. Each day, thousands of shoppers and window gazers flowed down Oxford Street, ignoring air raid alarms until German bombers appeared overhead. They dawdled and browsed over displays of goods ticketed for Christmas, in no hurry to pick up presents." Mary contributed to a Time story on December 30, 1940, about Blitzmas, describing how Londoners celebrated Christmas under the constant bombing. They abandoned traditional door-to-door caroling because of the blackout. Carrots replaced fruit in Blitzmas pudding, and beef or mutton stood in for Christmas turkey or goose. They hung holly without mistletoe, which came from France, and British children scoffed at peacetime toys and asked for dolls wearing gas masks or toy war equipment. The British dared not let down their guard, for as one woman said, "It would be just like that bloody Hitler to try his invasion on Christmas." In early 1941, Noel attended a party at the home of the colonial secretary, Oliver Stanley. He spent the most wonderful half hour of my life chatting with King George VI. They talked about the effect of the Blitz on the morale of the people. The king acted as an ordinary person might when visiting the home of a friend. During their talk, the king stammered, and so did Noel, fearing that as his old curse resurfaced, the king might think he was mocking him. Mary and Noel continued spending Sundays in bed until noon, reading the papers and chatting about the news. Noel busied himself writing his first book, and Mary helped edit it. Fighter Squadron traces the exploits of the pilots of the two hurricane fighter squadrons Noel had followed in France. He writes in a sensational style about dogfights and heroism and high adventure, focusing on the feats of New Zealand's ace, lion-hearted Cobber Kane. No one ever heard Cobber Kane brag. Nobody ever heard him go about with his chin stuck out, looking for trouble. Out of the cockpit of his fighting machine, he was mild-mannered and peace-loving. However, in the cockpit, he was a killer. What more could a nation at war ask of a son? The final paragraph of Fighter Squadron is sheer propaganda. There is a difference between unloading bombs on workers' homes in the dead of night and fighting it out in God's sky with the courageous daredevil fighting pilots of the Royal Air Force. On that difference hangs the fate of Britain. While Noel worked on his book, Mary made broadcasts to America from the BBC building's bomb-proof basement. "We used to meet in the dank and smelly cafeteria, deep in the roots of the building, for tea and a final reading of scripts before we went on air at 3 a.m. Mary met J.B. Priestley, the Yorkshire novelist who, in his nightly Britain Speaks series, sketched a forceful portrait of a unified Britain waging a people's war. He criticized the class system in England, arguing for social reform when they had won the war. He likened the struggle for independence from Nazi invasion and slavery to George Washington's battle for American freedom from tyranny. Graham Greene, the famous author, later remarked that in the months following Dunkirk, Priestley became a leader second in importance only to Winston Churchill. Mary found him pedantic and arrogant, though he did advise her that the most important quality in speaking is sounding sincere. She also worked with actor Leslie Howard, star of Gone with the Wind, whose broadcast followed hers. She enjoyed chatting with him and Priestley in the BBC cafeteria deep underground. Mary remembered walking home with Howard in the black and trembling streets, beneath the noisy sky, listening everywhere, all the time for a bomb scream to end in its bursting, watching the fires, washing off and shampooing out the stench of the sheltering tubes. A year later, Howard was dead after the plane in which he flew on a diplomatic mission to assist British intelligence was shot down by enemy aircraft. 4. A glamorous, globe-trotting war correspondent. December 1941 to April 1943. In her weekly letters to her parents, Mary extolled Noel's decency and her love for him. She bragged to her mother that Noel served her Sunday breakfast in bed and challenged her to get Tom, as she affectionately referred to her father, to serve her toast and tea. Mary celebrated their domestic bliss. On the evening of December 7th, 1941, Noel and Mary dined with friends at a fashionable restaurant in Park Lane. A reporter from the Express rushed in with the news that the Japanese had bombed Pearl Harbor. Everyone realized the Americans might now enter the war as combatants. Mary wrote in her diary, "My country is at war. May her victory be speedy and decisive, her peace worthy of the fight." Over the Christmas holidays, the monks spent a long weekend at Time's country house, Time Out, a stucco and timber house with large living rooms and many bedrooms, set among great trees near High Wycombe in the rolling hills of Buckinghamshire. They hiked and talked about the impact of the war. Since the summer, some 30,000 civilians had died in German bombing raids, mainly in London. Bombs had destroyed many homes, but Noel and Mary had been lucky, and as 1941 ended, they counted their blessings. In early January, the Express ordered Noel to Singapore, but while he made his way there, the island city fell to the Japanese. The Express redirected him to Australia, where he spent the next year covering the war in the Pacific. Mary could not help wondering if he spent time with his first family during his Australian assignment, but Noel said nothing about it in his letters. Mary told her parents she missed Noel and all the little things, whistling at me in a special way he has whenever I came in the door, snuggling on his lap, seeing his cheerful face smiling at me in the mornings, watching him prowl around the house like a flat-footed bear. She missed the balanced judgment he lends our mutual life and the protective barricade of love and affection with which he surrounds me and blocks out so much of the dreariness and pettiness of the world outside. She accepted his absence was necessary and did her best to cope by keeping herself busy with background assignments on the British economy and politics. During the early years of the war, Mary was the only female correspondent accredited to the RAF. After she joined Time Life, she became one of the first women accredited to the U.S. Army, and she wore a regulation uniform while on duty. Dozens of American women reporters had tried but failed to achieve this status, and Mary felt justifiably proud of the distinction. Though she was bound by Army rules and regulations, she had access to top officers and was on hand to write about U.S. military operations. Her identity card showed she was 5'3" tall, weighed 120 pounds, and enjoyed the rank of captain, likely one of the most petite officers in the U.S. Army. Her rank did not convey power to command, but allowed her access to the clubs reserved for officers. The black and white photo on her identity card was taken before she could have a uniform made by the tailor she and Noel shared. The lacy white collar of her blouse flowed over a dark sweater. Her hair color, described as light, shines with a blonde luster. Mary became one of the women correspondents writing under fire in bombed cities and on battlefields, covering what used to be a man's assignment. They were a capable, gutsy, and inquisitive bunch. In late January 1942, Mary took an overnight ferry across the Irish Sea to Belfast to cover the first American troops landing in the European theater. Though they were a small contingent, the Red Bull Division members were important symbolically. They arrived less than 2 months after the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor and signified America's commitment to defeating the Axis powers. Mary's byline featured on the piece she wrote for Life, and the lead photo shows a helmet-wearing American sergeant hugging her. Mary reported that the Yanks, as the Irish called them, were having a hard time keeping clean and warm in their Nissan huts, elongated igloos of corrugated iron with cement floors. She interviewed Irish girls who were most interested in meeting the soldiers. A hotel chambermaid, aged 19, with the blue-black hair of the Normans and the blue eyes and white skin of the Celts, breathed, "Ah, 'twill be lovely to meet them." Local businessmen built wooden dance halls where soldiers met Irish girls. Four respectable colleens still don't go to pubs. Mary concluded, "In the Ulster mists, sensible boys from the Midwest should grow no more discontented than armies anywhere and fonder of home than ever, unless Nazi bullets interfere." On her return to London, Mary worked on short pieces for Time Life and completed a lengthy study on the economic effects of the war on Britain, which traced the advance of socialism in the country. She met Harold Lasky, a professor of economics and political theory at the London School of Economics, who came to be her hero. Lasky was the intellectual leader of the non-communist British left, and he believed that only a socialist state could bring about a free society. In her draft memoir, Mary described Harold Lasky as the brilliant leftist political scientist whose contemporary pronouncements I cherished as near dogma. She developed a keen interest in British politics and was influenced by her friends Lasky and Michael Foot as her political views moved left. Mary told her parents she was working steadily, but she was also eating well. The generosity of her friends allowed her to live beyond her means. Soon after Noel left, Mary realized it wouldn't do any good to shut herself away moping. One general who took a romantic interest in Mary was Brigadier General Robert McClure, the military attaché to the American Embassy in London. In 1942, General Eisenhower appointed him Chief of Intelligence for the European Theater of Operations. McClure was 11 years older than Mary and possessive of her. She did not see the relationship going beyond the war or affecting her marriage, but she appreciated McClure's doting. In May 1942, Noel cabled Mary, telling her they might transfer him to Washington. She was excited by this news because she was planning a trip to America in July, and she hoped they could synchronize their visits. Mary told her parents that nothing could pry her away from London if it weren't for them. "It's not disloyalty, this feeling, or being un-American. It's that London is the most interesting city in the world. Despite my affection for so many things and people at home, my interests and my friends are here." Mary asked them to look at the cover story for Time on June 15, 1942, which she had written about General Brian Somerville, the man in charge of organizing the vast supplies to invade Europe. Somerville has plenty of ways of getting action. He also knows where to go when he needs big things, but other agencies block his path. Somerville had two potent friends in Washington, Harry Hopkins and Franklin Delano Roosevelt. In July 1942, Mary traveled on the Atlantic Clipper, a British Overseas Airways flying boat, a luxurious single-hulled plane capable of landing and taking off from water to New York. Times P.I. Prentice reported, "Two of America's top flight generals saw her off. General Dwight Ike Eisenhower, commander of U.S. forces in Europe, and Brigadier General Robert McClure, the U.S. military attaché in London." This was enduring evidence of Mary's tight connections with the high command. Time brought Mary to New York to learn about the operations of the magazine. Once she understood the office culture, she discovered she'd attained greater privileges than other women in the company. She told her parents, "The office is working me steadily as a Time writer, that is, one of the little squad of people, supposed here to be very exalted, who polish off the cables from abroad and the news as it comes in the papers. The edited material appears in Time. I am the first woman they've ever had writing foreign affairs, though there are lots of women around as secretaries and researchers. Therefore, everybody is watching me and the stuff I turn out very closely." Mary was well qualified because she had reported about the war from London for years and had more experience than the men in the New York office. She worked hard and wrote several published pieces. The female researchers who didn't feel intimidated by her success were friendly. Men in the office ignored her and did not include her in their business lunches or drinks after work. An exception was William "Bill" Walton, who had become a lifelong friend. Born to a prosperous newspaper-owning businessman and his artistic wife, Walton was 2 years older than Mary. Tall, blonde, and handsome, with an endearing lopsided smile, Walton had a self-assured, easygoing manner and a talent for friendship others found attractive. Years later, Walton was called the epitome of a life enhancer, someone who always added to the joy of life, someone who made any group of people snap and crackle. With the onset of the war in Europe, Time Life began building up its team of reporters, and they invited Walton to join the company. He worked in the New York headquarters, and when Mary arrived, he shared his office with her. Soon, she called him Willie, and he called her Welshie, and they enjoyed snappy chats about life and became close. Walton told Mary his wife suffered from depression and mental instability, and he worried how she would manage with their children if Time posted him to London. Meanwhile, Mary informed her parents several publishers had asked her to write books and articles about her war experience in Britain. Tom shared his pride at her recognition as a serious journalist. Adeline thought Mary had done enough for the war effort and that she should stay home in the safety of America. Mary rejected her mother's appeals, writing, "I know how you feel about it, Mummy, that I've done my bit about the war and ought to be able now to sit back and take it easy." She couldn't do that because there is a tremendous job to be done by my generation toward winning this war, and particularly toward winning the peace afterward. My place is going back to London and writing about it for America. Mary displayed as much commitment as any soldier. She would do her vital job, writing about the war so Americans would understand the stakes. Mary visited her parents in Thief River Falls, Minnesota, finding them healthy but agitated about how little money they had. She deposited funds in their account from her small salary and said she would help provide for them, and she kept her promise. Mary felt lucky in her parents. None of my friends' fathers, benign as they might be, were as graceful or poetic as my father, and few of my friends' mothers were as pretty or witty as mine. The Bemidji Pioneer reported that Mary was feted at neighborhood gatherings when she visited Thief River Falls and Bemidji. Her job is to make sure Times editors and readers get the insider's viewpoint, and for that purpose, her friendships with so many of the great and near great are invaluable. The Fargo Daily Tribune declared, "Mary lived the life of a glamorous, globe-trotting war correspondent. She had married the famous war journalist Noel Monks, and there was a Hollywood touch to her career." The local papers celebrated Mary's escape from small-town life. In late November, Noel arrived in New York, and Mary moved to a larger apartment overlooking the skyline for his one-month visit. They went to plays, dined out with friends, and enjoyed the city as far as their budget allowed. Mary wrote to her parents, "Everything seems to come alive when we are together, and when we are apart, no matter how nice things are, life seems awfully dead." She told them, "Noel has not stopped growing in mental and spiritual breadth and depth, and each time we come together again after a separation, I find more things to love and be proud of. We have so much to be thankful for." Their month together had been like a honeymoon. Mary was delighted when the Express posted Noel back to London. On January 1, 1943, Mary left on a flying boat, and Noel followed in the refurbished coal bunker of a British steamer, the Red Duster. Mary's trip was extended when authorities pushed her off one plane at Bermuda to make way for people with higher priorities. Mary told her parents she stayed in Bermuda for 13 days of wonderful, hot, bright sunshine, palm trees, bananas ripening, and sea and sky even bluer than Minnesota's. Mary was glad to arrive in London and see everyone looking so fit and healthy, despite the rationing. She wrote to her father that the British wanted to turn the war to good account to improve all the people's health and freedom from want and fear. Even the big corporations held meetings and put up reports on improvements to the national economy. Mary thought Americans, in contrast, were less optimistic and were fighting to get back something they had lost. Austerity became a way of life for the Monks, and they stayed in their tiny flat each night while Noel worked on his book and Mary did odd writing jobs. Mary told her parents she bothered Noel by snuggling her nose under his second chin or chewing his ear. There were still splurges, and on her birthday they went out with friends to a revival of Showboat. During the spring, Mary and Noel began drifting apart. While he traveled around Britain covering the British Army, she wrote about American strategic and political issues in London. They had less in common, and their incompatible work schedules meant even when they were both in London, they had little time for long walks together. Quiet evenings at home became rare, and they shared fewer confidences. Among our friends, a dozen other couples appeared to be having similar difficulties. Earlier, Mary had hoped to get pregnant, but now the time was not right. In mid-June 1943, Noel left England aboard a British destroyer to report on U.S. troops landing on Sicily. He followed as they fought.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.